Yes, students, good morning. Welcome to the second session. In last class, we discussed about some basics of thermodynamics. And first one, we discussed about what is a system, what is surrounding, and what is boundary, and what is universe, right? So system is nothing but anything. Yes, somebody is talking. So it is the fixed quantity of matter or a region in the space where we are studying the thermodynamic behaviors. That is nothing but the system. I have given example for that also, right? Now, and anything outside the system is called surrounding, and the system and surrounding are separated by a wall. That is called boundary. Okay, that's what I discussed in last class. And some students asked me, sir, please explain me about piston cylinder, right? Yes or no? Anyone?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So what I will do now, first I will explain what is piston, what is cylinder, how they works, how they are going to be, because the whole thermodynamics I am talking about piston cylinder. Unless and until you don't know the exact view of piston cylinder, you don't get the concept what I am saying. So first I will explain what is system, what is cylinder, sorry, what is piston, what is cylinder, I will explain. Now, are you able to see the photo here?
Yes, sir.
Yeah,
yes,
I'll
sir.
Take the pen. Now, if you see here, this is the cut section of a bike engine. That is what four-stroke petrol engine. Okay. If you see, this is the engine cylinder, the red-colored one with the blade structure. We can call these blades are the fins. Okay. So, time being, you know what is piston, what is cylinder. Extra thing, anyhow, you will study in the next semester. That is in applied thermodynamics. Whereas coming to for thermodynamics, you should know what is piston. What is cylinder? So what is the friend? What is the drawing of that means in front of you, how they look like? Okay, now, so you can see here, this is nothing but the cylinder. Are you able to see my pointer? Red color pointer. Anyone?
Sir.
Yes, sir.
This is the cylinder.
Yes,
inside
sir.
The cylinder, and this
yes,
is the
sir.
Piston. Okay. Now this is the piston. Okay, so now if you see inside the cylinder, the piston always reciprocates. Okay, and you already studied in engineering drawing or engineering graphics. For a cylinder, what is the front view? If you take a
rectangle.
Cylinder, rectangle.
Rectangle.
Yeah. Rectangle, very good. So that's why for the cylinder, cylinder is a rectangle, cylindrical member, and piston is also a cylindrical member. So the front view of piston and cylinder will be a rectangle. So that's why whenever I'm sorry.
There is a lag in your voice, sir.
Please,
poor data, sir.
Poor data, sir. I'm not using any data. I'm using
poor
only
data.
Wi-Fi only.
Sir, no, sir. The student's
no, sir. Student
data is poor.
Yeah, that's what.
Students,
maybe your side
students,
lag is there. Okay. Anyhow, stop the incoming video so that it will be clear somewhat.
Okay.
Right now.
Okay.
So here, whenever I'm talking about piston cylinder, I used to draw only rectangles because the front view of the piston and cylinder is a rectangle. Okay. Now this view is the cut section of four-stroke petrol engine. Now I'll go to next one. Now you can see here, is it is more clear compared to previous figure, right?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Much clear.
Yes. Now you can see this white color one is the this is your cylinder, and the red colored one is the piston. So inside the cylinder, the piston will reciprocates. Inside the cylinder, the piston will reciprocates. Okay. So just to know the idea of piston cylinder, I am showing how it will work, how the what are the different parts. Anyhow, you will study in the next semester. Don't worry about that. First, you should know how the why I am drawing rectangle every time for the piston and cylinder. You should have idea. So the view of the cylinder is a rectangle. So therefore, I am drawing a rectangle for the piston cylinder assembly. Now, this is one. Yeah, this is one more diagram. So these all cut sections are available in the lab. Whenever you are coming to the college, you can come and see the cut sections. Okay, no problem in that. Now here you can see here. This is your cylinder. And the silver colored one is the piston. Basically, the pistons are made up of aluminum alloys. Okay, so that's why the color is like silver. Now here also you can see this is the piston and this is the cylinder. So always the piston will reciprocates inside the cylinder to and from motion. Just it will move up and down with help of connecting rod, crankshaft, flywheel, everything will be there. These parts are there anyhow for any engine. Okay, now you got clarity what is piston, what is cylinder?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, now I will go to the subject. Now I will go to the subject.
Sir, what is the difference between 4S and 2S, sir?
That's what you don't want about technical terms right now. What okay. Four stroke engine, two stroke engine. So for anyhow you asked, right? So two stroke engines are high pickup engines. Initial pickup will be more in two stroke engine and more pollution will be there. Whereas coming to four stroke engine, initial pickup will be less, less pollution will be there. Okay. So generally okay, for sir. sports purpose, two stroke engines are used. Okay. So again, one okay, more small example I will give. If you are mixing oil with the petrol, that is two-stroke engine. If you don't mix oil, only petrol is pouring into the petrol tank, that is four-stroke. For a common man, lazy person can understand. If you are mixing lubricating oil along with the petrol, that is called two-stroke engine. If there is separate crankcase or oil chamber for the engine, that is four-stroke. Right, that is required for you. Okay, so need not worry how it will work, anything, it will be none of our business right now.
Okay, now,
coming to the classification of system, today's topic. So basically, thermodynamic systems are classified into three categories. That is closed system, open system, and isolated system. Okay, now, so closed system means it is a fixed mass system. No mass can enter, no mass can leave. Mass, whatever it is present inside the system, it is fixed. Only energy can enter or leave the system. Nothing but heat can be added to the system or heat can be cross the or leave the system. Okay. So the volume of the closed system need not to be fixed. Only mass is fixed. Okay. Now the best example will be a cup of coffee with a lid on it. So what will happen if the cup of coffee, it is in hot condition, it starts evaporating. If you don't keep any lid over that, what will happen? So its mass is also going to decrease in the form of vapors. Suppose if you keep lid on the coffee cup or coffee glass, what will happen? So the vapors or the vapors leaving the coffee will be stick to the plate, and due to the atmospheric conditions, that vapors will get condensed. Again, they will be converted into liquid. So therefore, there is no change in the mass. Only heat is crossing from the coffee cup to the surrounding atmosphere. Okay, now you can see here.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, now you can see here. This is the closed system. As I said, closed system, it is a fixed mass system. I can see there is no exchange of mass. Only exchange of energy is going to take place. Now you can see, what is this one? Tell me. Anyway, what is this one? What is the name of this component? This rectangular component?
Boundary. It's a boundary, sir.
No,
boundary.
This is the cylinder.
Cylinder.
Right. Now, cylinder. What about this small one? This small rectangle?
Piston.
This is the piston. Very good. Right. Now, this is the cylinder. This is the piston. Right. So, piston is in fixed position. Therefore, mass is fixed. Only I can add heat to the system or I can extract heat from the system. Now, second example, let us assume, as I already explained, fixed boundary, mobile boundary. Let us consider a gas inside the cylinder of mass 2 kg and volume 1 meter cube. Now after some time, what I'm doing, I'm adding some heat external to the system. So as the properties of gases, we know, if you add heat to the gas, its molecule will get energized, activated. The kinetic energy of the molecules will be increased. Thereby, they are going to collide each other due to the different velocities. During that process, momentum exchange will take place within the system, between the molecules. So momentum exchange means one particle will be having different mass and different velocity, is going to collide with the other particle, other molecule of different mass and different velocity. During this process, they will exchange their energies. So thereby, what happened? Its temperature is going to increase and pressure is also going to increase because we are adding external heat. So therefore, when the pressure is increases, what happens? This is the mobile boundary. It starts moving upward direction. So let us say this is the initial position of the piston. Now this is the final position of the piston after application of the heat. So thereby, if you see, there is no change in the mass. Earlier it is 2 kg, now also it is 2 kg, but the volume is increased due to the addition of the heat from 1 meter cube to the 3 meter cube. So that is the reason you remember wherever you go, closure system means it is a fixed mass, it's not fixed volume. Volume of the closure system can be vary, but mass remains fixed. Is it is clear, closure system?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Now,
yes, sir.
Coming to the open system. So open system means in this mass can enter, mass can leave. Energy can enter, energy can leave. Okay, na? So both mass and energy, matter and energy can be entered or can be leave from the system. Okay. Now we can call this open system as control mass. Mass is remains fixed, only volume is going to, sorry, volume is fixed and mass is going to vary. This is reverse of your closure system. In closure system, mass is fixed, volume is varied. In open system, volume is fixed, mass is vary. But best example, our water geysers. Water geysers, if you see, the volume remains fixed, only can water enter into the system and heat will be added with help of heaters and hot water can leave. Okay, na? So, but the net volume of the heater remains fixed. Only the amount of matter entering into the system, the mass is entering, can be varied and mass can be leaving, can be varied. Okay, so both mass and heat can enter, can leave the system. And one more example is, now if you see open bowl and if you apply the heat, what are these things? These are the vapors. Vapors contain certain matter. So due to the heat addition, the vapors are escaping into the atmosphere. Nothing but the mass is going to change. At the same time, we are adding the heat and some amount of heat will be lost to the surroundings. So heat is released and mass is also moving out of the system. This is the case of open system. So open system means it is a control volume. Control volume means only volume is fixed, mass can be varied. So in this case, if you see, let us consider a control volume, mass is entering and mass is leaving. And energy is entering, energy is leaving. So a best example is open cup of coffee without lid. If you keep the lid, what will happen? Those vapors again condensed and they will be stored inside the cup only. Means there is no change of mass in case of if you keep the lid. If you remove the lid, what will happen? The vapors will escape to the atmosphere. Certain mass is going to lose. That is the reason. The best example for open system is your water geyser and open cup of coffee. Clear?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir, human body is also an open system, right?
Yeah, human body is also an open system.
Okay, sir.
Because we are taking food as the input and the exit is also there. At the same time, our body is absorbing the heat and it is emitting the heat. Human body is also an example for the open system. Right.
Yes, sir. Okay, sir.
Coming to the isolated system, neither mass nor energy can cross the boundary. Means no addition of heat, no addition of mass. No removal of heat, no removal of mass. Your best example is, sorry? Babu, please
sir,
listen.
Nothing.
Don't comment in between. Whenever I ask, then only you reply, please. Okay. Right. Please mute your mic. Right. So neither energy nor mass is allowed to cross the boundary. So the mass is fixed, heat or energy is also fixed. The best example is thermos flask. Let us say if you store the coffee in thermos flask and let us assume the lid is completely closed. For certain amount of time, it will be acting as a isolated system. If you, let us say, if the time is increased also, there will be certain losses will be there. Okay. So for certain interval of time, thermos flask will be an isolated system. No mass can enter the system. No mass can leave the system. No heat can be added. No heat can be removed. There will be some insulation between the flask and the surroundings. Okay. So this is nothing but this hatched one is the insulation. This is your flask. This is your surrounding atmosphere. In order to avoid the heat loss, we are using some thermocol like that. Nowadays, we are using some foams also for vacuuming purpose. Okay. Now, isolated system, isolated system means it neither exchange energy nor mass. Suppose if it exchanges mass with the surroundings, work is nothing but mass. Suppose if it exchanging mass with the surroundings, then it is called adiabatic system. Adiabatic system means it exchanges only work, not the heat. That is called isolated adiabatic system. That is the thing. Now, coming to the next
topic.
What is mean
by work?
That's what, if you add in, we will study work, about the work in second unit. If you add certain heat input to the anything, any engine, it will produce some output. That is called work. So generally heat engines will work. Let us see, if you add heat to the engine, it will convert heat energy into work energy. The conversion of energy is possible. That is called work. Okay. So you know, in our human case, if you see, we are taking food as the input and we are doing certain output. That output is nothing but the work. Okay.
Yes.
Right. Okay. Now coming to the energy. So energy will be of different forms, right? So as a mechanical engineer, we know our energies may be kinetic energy, potential energy, and according to thermodynamic point of view, heat energy is there, right? At the same time, we have electric energy, magnetic energy, chemical, nuclear, so many energies are available, okay? And if you see, energy is nothing but the capacity to do the work, yes or no? So because work is the rate of doing, so work, power is the rate of doing work, energy is the capacity to do the work, okay? So as we know, according to definition of work done is nothing but force into distance. The capacity means with respect to time. So therefore, Newton meter per second, it will become joules per second. The energy units are watts and kilowatts. So there is no difference between power and energy. Power maybe we are measuring in terms of watt, but energy we are measuring in kilowatt. Okay, now, so the total energy per mass is called specific energy. Whenever you are doing the problems, if mass of the system is not given, so by default, we can assume it as a unit mass and the units will become per kg. So you are taking mass as unity, then we can write units are per kg, we can write. That is called specific properties, we can say. Specific properties means that value per mass is called specific property. Okay, now, so basically the energies are divided into two groups, macroscopic energy and microscopic energy. So macroscopic energy is related to our motion and position and gravity. So motion, position and gravity. Nothing but the best examples of macroscopic energies are kinetic energy, potential energy. So we are considering only these two as we are mechanical students. So we are interested in only kinetic and potential energy. If let us say triple E people are there, they will concentrate in electricity, electric energy like that, and magnetism, everything, right? So as a mechanical point of view, we are considering only kinetic energy and potential energy. Whereas coming to microscopic energy is chemical energy, nuclear, latent heat, sensible heat, and etc. Okay, as a mechanical, I'm concentrating in only latent heat and sensible heat. And the total energies are called as internal energy. Internal energy is the energy stored within the body. Okay, I'll discuss one by one in the next slides. So we have, please mute your mics. Right. So here in macroscopic, we are going to study about kinetic energy and potential energy. In microscopic, we are studying about latent heat and sensible heat. Okay. Now, can anyone tell me what is kinetic energy? What is kinetic energy?
Which is in virtue of motion.
Yes.
Yes,
sir. The energy possessed by the body by virtue of its motion, right? Na? So it motion. Can be, yes. It is equal to half into m into v square, where m is the mass of the body, v is the velocity of the body, right? Now, so as we know, total energy of two types, macroscopic and microscopic. In macroscopic, we are interested in only kinetic energy and potential energy. In microscopic energy, it is internal energy, nothing but sensible heat and latent heat we are going to study. The sum of macro and micro are called total energy. Total energy is the combination of macroscopic energy and microscopic energy. So the energy by virtue of its motion is called kinetic energy. The energy due to its position with respect to some reference. If the body is certain height from the datum, so the height corresponding to it consists of potential energy, where Z is the height of the body with respect to the datum, nothing but elevation. So M into G into Z or M into G into H is the potential energy. So other forms of energies are these things, but you are concentrated only in kinetic energy and potential energy. The sum of kinetic energy and potential energy is called macroscopic energy. Now coming to the microscopic energy, so we are concentrating only in sensible heat and latent heat. So sensible heat means the heat we are supplying only to increase its temperature, not to change the phase of a system. So basically phase means we'll discuss in the coming slides, but for time being, you know, a water can exist in three phases, right? Solid phase, liquid phase, and gaseous phase, right? In solid phase it is ice, in liquid phase it is water, in gaseous phase it is vapor or steam, we can say. Okay, now so the amount of heat, sensible heat we are supplying to the system, is used to increase its only temperature, not to change the phase of a body, sensible heat. Whereas coming to latent heat, let us consider water at a temperature of 20 degree centigrade. Let us consider we have a water at a temperature 20 degree centigrade. If I add some sensible heat to this water, its temperature may be increased to 70 degree or 80 degree. Still, when the water is at 20 degree centigrade, what is the form of water? It is liquid form. When the temperature is increased to 70 degrees also, the water is at liquid form, means there is no change in the phase. So earlier it is liquid phase, now also after adding the heat also it is in the liquid phase. That heat we are adding to the system is called sensible heat. Whereas coming to the latent heat, let us assume the temperature of the system is 70 degree. Now I am adding some external heat. After adding external heat, let us assume the water temperature is increased to 110 degree centigrade. So now at 110 degree centigrade, is the liquid phase exist? No. So once the boiling point of water is 100 degree centigrade, once the temperature of water crosses 100 degree centigrade, it will be converted into steam. Therefore, the phase will be vapor phase. But in these two cases, the phase is liquid phase. Means I want to differentiate sensible heat and latent heat. Sensible heat is used to increase the temperature of a system, but not changing the phase. Whereas coming to latent heat is used to change the phase of a system from liquid to vapor or vapor to something, whatever it may be. So the latent heat we are applying to the system is used to change the phase of a system. Is it is clear or not? Sensible heat and latent heat.
Yes, sir.
Clear.
Sensible heat is used to increase the temperature of a system, not to change the phase. Whereas coming to latent heat is used to change the phase of the system. Means we are adding the temperature in this case also. Due to the temperature addition, due to that heat addition, there is change of phase taking place in the system. Okay, now you can see here, I can keep some small figure at the bottom. So in first case, are you able to see these numbers? In the first case, the water is at 60 degree Fahrenheit, nothing but 15.6 degree centigrade. I'm adding sensible heat to the water, so thereby its temperature is increased to 15.6 to 100 degree centigrade, right? Na? So therefore, in both the cases, the water is in liquid phase only. Now second case, the water is at 100 degree centigrade. Now I'm adding latent heat. Latent is only heat only. So I'm calling it as sensible heat and latent heat. In both the cases, I'm adding some external heat only. So due to that, the temperature is increased to above the 100 degree centigrade, and the phase is going to change into vapor phase. Okay, now, so you can see sensible heat is related to change in temperature of the gas or object with no change of the phase. Whereas coming to latent heat is related to change in the phase between the liquid and gases and solids.
So change in the temperature, sir, in latent heat?
No. Temperature will be changed. Here it is not shown correctly. So because if you add the heat above the 100, it will be increased. When temperature is increased at 100 degree centigrade, water starts boiling. If you increase the temperature beyond, so that water will be converted into steam. So that's why there will be change of phase from liquid to vapor will be there, definitely. You can see this is the vapor. The shape he is denoting, this is the vapor. Clear now?
Yes, sir.
Means we studied about macroscopic energy and microscopic energy. Macroscopic, we studied kinetic energy and potential energy. In microscopic energy, we studied about sensible heat and latent heat. And these two combined together, we can call it as internal energy. We can see even chemical energy, when two chemicals are undergoing reaction, they exit some heat. That is nothing but the chemical energy. In the same way, we have nuclear energy also. Okay, so now
sir, what is chemical energy, sir?
If two chemicals are undergoing reaction, So there, if you studied in chemistry, there will be endothermic reaction, exothermic reactions.
Yes, sir.
Yes, right. So hey, if you, sir. Sorry. Okay, right. So when two chemicals are going for undergoing reaction, chemical reaction, so there will be heat release will be there. Sometimes you need to supply some heat also, right? So those reactions will be there. Anyhow, we are not interested in chemical energy and nuclear energy right now. We required only because we are studying thermodynamic point of view. I want what is sensible heat, what is latent heat. By this point of time, everyone should be clear about sensible heat and latent heat. You should not have any doubt in between what is sensible heat, what is latent heat, okay? Now the sum of macroscopic and microscopic energy is called total energy. Nothing but kinetic energy, potential energy is nothing but macro, and internal energy is the microscopic energy. Okay, so right. So this is the internal energy. Internal energy is the energy possessed by the body within itself, and kinetic energy due to its velocity or its motion, and potential energy due to its position. Suppose in this, let us assume the body is in rest position. What is the meaning of that? Even the body is rest position, velocity is zero, nothing but kinetic energy is zero, and the body is on the ground itself. There is no datum. In that case, Z is equals to zero if the body is on the ground. Therefore, potential energy is also zero. In the absence of kinetic energy and potential energy, the total energy is equal to only internal energy. Yes or no? In the absence of kinetic energy and potential energy, the total energy of a system is equal to internal energy. That is the case of you can see closed system. In the closed system, is mass is going to change? No. There is no mass is entering or no mass is leaving. No energy is entering, no energy is leaving. So in the closed system, whatever the heat supplied, so because the total energy in case in the absence of kinetic and potential energy is the internal energy, E is equals to U. If there is no velocity, no position, meaning that if you add, right? So there is no heat addition, no heat rejection, no mass addition, no mass rejection. Okay, all closed systems, total energy is nothing but its internal energy. Whatever the energy is at the starting, the same energy will remain throughout the system. Clear? I can call it as a stationary system. All closed systems, total energy equal to internal energy. Is it is okay?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Okay, sir.
Okay, next. What is the properties of a system? What is property? Property is nothing but a quantity is said to be property if and only if its change in value between two states is independent of the process. So don't worry about it. It is very lengthy, right? So let us consider a physical quantity is said to be a property. It has to obey these three conditions. Any physical quantity, let us say pressure, volume, temperature, any example if you take. If I want to say this pressure is a property of a system, it should obey the following three conditions. It does not depend on the process. It does not depend on the state. It does not depend. It is a exact differential. So you don't know what is state at right now. You don't know what is process. Just keep away. I will discuss in the next slides. Now the properties are now we'll discuss only these three now. So thermodynamic properties can be either intensive property, extensive property, and specific property. I will discuss about the state, process, everything in the next coming slides. Okay. So because a physical quantity is said to be a property, then it has to obey these three conditions. That is my aim of this slide. Now the properties are three types: intensive property, extensive property, and specific property. Intensive property is nothing but if any physical quantity, please mute your mic, somebody is unmuted. If physical quantity is said to be intensive property, if it is independent of mass, let us consider a closed chamber is separated by a boundary. Let us assume a boundary. One side you have gas, other side you have a gas. Please listen. Let us assume the volume is equals to 1 meter cube here. The volume is equals to 2 meter cube over here. The pressure of the gas on left side of the chamber is, let us say, 2 bar. The pressure of the gas on the right chamber is also 2 bar. You got my point? Let us consider a closed container. In that container, it is separated by a boundary. A wall is separating, right? It is the imaginary wall. Let us assume it is an imaginary or temporary wall. One side of the boundary, or let us say left side of the system, it is a gas of volume 1 m³, and mass is equals to 2 kg on left side, and on right side mass is equals to 4 kg. Let us assume. Okay, on right side the volume is different, pressure is same, mass is different.
Ready, sir?
Sir,
excuse me, Reddy sir, this is Prabhu here.
Sir, good morning, sir.
Yeah, good morning, sir. Is there, how is the response, sir, today?
Today, one second, sir. The students are 50, 49, sir.
Yeah, yeah, good. Sir. So anyway, no problem, you know, sir. There, no, all the facilities have been provided there.
Yes, sir. Good, sir. Everything is good, sir.
Good, sir. Thank you very much. Sir. Thank you.
Right. Yeah. Now see here. Suppose if I remove this boundary. Please observe everyone. If I remove this boundary, can you tell me what is the pressure of all the system? Anyone? Are you able to hear
same
my voice?
Same, sir.
Okay, now not pressure. Let us assume. What is the mass of the total system if I remove this boundary? If I remove this boundary, what is the mass of the total system?
6 kg.
Total mass is equals to? 6 kg. What is the total volume? What is total volume?
3 meter cube.
Then what about pressure?
2, sir.
4.
Will it be 2 bar or 4 bar? Will it be 2 bar or 4 bar?
2 bar.
4 bar.
4 bar.
Yes, sir.
4 bar. One more thing. Let us assume. One second. The temperature is 20 degree centigrade here. The temperature here also, let us say 20 degree centigrade. Now, what is the temperature of total system?
Same 20 degree centigrade.
Now, temperature is 20 or 40 now?
20.
20, sir.
20, right? And pressure?
2. Pressure?
See, now look here. The pressure will be 2 bar only. Temperature is 20 degree centigrade. What you understood from this diagram means this property, pressure and temperature, are does not depend upon the size or mass of the system. Agree?
Yes sir. It depends.
Only the mass,
sir,
is going to vary and volume is going to vary, but the pressure and temperature remains constant.
Yes, sir.
Meaning that if the properties, sir, are independent of mass or independent of size, then those properties are called intensive properties. Agree? What are the examples for intensive property? Pressure, temperature, etc. Whereas opposite to the intensive property, we have extensive property. Extensive properties, they depends on the mass or size of the system.
Mass,
volume, weight, these are all extensive properties. Agree? Now we can see a property which is independent of the mass or size of the system is called intensive property. Example, pressure and temperature. Whereas coming to extensive properties,
depends upon mass.
Yeah. If the properties are depends on the mass or size of your system, that is called extensive property. Now you can, from this figure, it is self-explanatory. Agree?
Yes, sir.
This figure is self-explanatory, right? Now, let us assume the whole system is, let us say, at a temperature of 30 degree centigrade. If you take individual parts also, they are at a 30 degree centigrade. Like that, you can explain intensive property. You can also explain extensive property also, right? If you remove one mass from this, the weight is, the total mass is going to change, yes or no, right? So both you can explain from this intensive as well as extensive property. Clear, intensive, extensive? You should not get confused. Very, very important from interview point of view. What are intensive properties? Yes, what are extensive properties? I will give one small hint. Intensive, starting letter is I. I is nothing but independent. So which is independent of mass. If it is independent, other one is dependent on mass. Like that you can right, remember sir. Easily. Instead right, of sir. Getting confused, independent intensive property, it is starting with IN or I, it is nothing but independent of mass. The other thing will be dependent on mass, okay? Right. Now, as okay, I told, intensive properties are over, extensive properties are over. Now we have specific property. See, as I just now, I told specific energy. What is specific energy? Anything for mass is called it specific. Yes or no, right? Specific energy means total energy per mass is called specific energy. Any property per mass is called it specific. Now you can see specific volume. What is specific volume? Volume per mass. Specific energy, energy per mass. Specific internal energy per mass, right? Na? So all the extensive properties per mass is called specific property. Now, if you say specific volume, let us assume. Volume is equals to, let us say 2 meter cube. Mass is equals to, let us say 2 kg. Right, let us assume this side I have one meter cube and 1 kg, 1 meter cube, 1 kg, right? Now tell me, what is the specific volume of this portion?
2 only, sir.
Specific one. Volume, 1 only.
One.
Specific one volume means volume by mass. Specific volume usually denoted with small letter V. Small letter V is the symbol to represent specific volume. Specific volume can be defined as the ratio of volume per mass. So, because volume is intensive property or extensive property?
Extensive property.
Right. So, extensive property per unit mass is becoming intensive property. Got my point? Specific property is nothing but per mass. All extensive properties per unit mass will be converted into intensive property, because extensive properties are dependent on mass. Yes or no? Extensive properties, volume is depends on mass. That's why I am dividing with mass. If I divide with mass, again it will be independent of mass. Agree?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
That's what specific property means. If you divide the extensive property with mass, they will become intensive property. That is my main idea of specific property. If you divide extensive property with respect to mass, then they will become intensive property. Examples are specific volume, specific energy. These are intensive property because I'm dividing with mass. So volume alone is the extensive property. If I divide with mass, then it is called specific volume. That is called intensive property. Okay. And density, one more physical quantity, it is density. Density can be called it as mass per volume. So mass per volume is called density. Mass units are kg and volume units are meter cube. So kg per meter cube are the units for the specific volume. And reciprocal of density is called specific volume. So specific volume is volume per mass. Density is mass per volume. Means the product of density is denoted by symbol rho and specific volume is denoted by symbol small v. The product of density and specific volume is equal to 1 always, because volume is reciprocal of specific volume is reciprocal of density. The product of density into specific volume is equals to 1. Okay. And one more important term, relative density or specific gravity. Relative density or specific gravity. We can define these two terms in two ways with respect to, one second, new empty slide. Right. Now relative density or specific gravity. So relative density or specific gravity, we can define in two ways. So I can define with respect to density, or I can define with respect to specific weight. Anybody know what is specific weight? Weight per volume is called specific weight. And density is defined as mass by volume. Density is defined as mass by volume. specific weight is defined as weight by volume. So let us say water is a reference for anything. So the density of water is equals to 1000 kg per meter cube. The density of water is equals to 1000. Is it is understandable the writing, because I am writing with the mouse. Please try to cooperate for some time. Maybe it will take more 1 week to get the everything will be settled. Okay, is it is clearly right? Now the density of water I am writing, because water is the standard one for any fluid. We will take water H2O as the reference. So density of water is 1000 kg per meter cube. Now, so what is as I said, specific weight is equals to, I can write weight by volume. How to define weight? Yesterday I said how to define weight. Weight is the product of weight mass into gravity. Mass into gravity. Now I can write m by v into g. Is it is okay? I can write m by v into g. What is m by v is called? M by v is called what?
Density.
What is the density of water? 1000. What is the gravity? Gravity is 9.81 meter per second square. Therefore, specific weight of water, how much it will be? Tell me now. Specific weight of water is equal to this 10, is 1000 and this is 9.8. 9,810. What are the units? Kg meter per second square. Kg meter per second square divided by volume. Volume is meter cube, because see, mass is kg, gravity is meter per second square, and volume is meter cube. What is kg meter per second square? Newton. Newton per meter cube is the unit for the specific weight. Is it is clear? So throughout your engineering, you should remember specific weight of water is equals to 9810. It is standard value. Nobody will give in the problems. So density of water is 1000 kg per meter cube, and specific weight of water is 9810 Newton per meter cube. Now it is clear? Now I have a fluid. Please listen. And specific gravity is denoted by symbol S, capital S. Capital S is the symbol used to represent specific gravity. Okay. And sometimes they will use capital R also, because I am calling it as relative density or specific gravity. I can use either capital S or capital R to use symbol for specific gravity. So now let us assume I have a fluid. Its specific gravity is equals to 0.9. Please listen. Specific gravity doesn't have any unit. Why? Because I will tell you. Now let us assume I have a fluid.
Sir, specific gravity is nothing but relative density, right, sir?
Yeah, both are same. Name is different. That's it. I can call it as specific gravity, or I can also call it as relative density. Okay, sir. Now I have a certain fluid. I don't know the name of the fluid. Its specific gravity is 0.9. I want density of the fluid. How to get? Got my question? I have a fluid. I know only its specific gravity. I want to calculate its density. In order to do this, you should know the definition of specific gravity. So specific gravity can be defined in two ways, as I told. So it is the ratio of density of given fluid divided by density of the standard fluid. Standard fluid I am considering as a water. I can define specific gravity in terms of density, or also I can define in terms of specific weight. So I can define it as specific weight of given fluid divided by specific weight of water. So for this given problem, I can use this formula, yes or no? I can use this formula. In this one, S is given, S value is given as 0.9, and I know the density of water is 1000. Therefore, density of given fluid is equals to 1000 multiplied by 0.9. So it gives the 900 kg per meter cube. Is this clear?
Yes, sir.
right? So it means if you know the specific gravity of any fluid, its density can be calculated. And if you know specific weight of any fluid, its density can be calculated. Agree? So this is the main definition of specific gravity. If it is clear, I will go to next slide.
Okay, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, go to the slide. Right, clear, na? So relative density or specific gravity, I can define. It is the ratio of density of given substance to the some standard substance. What is standard substance? Always we will take water as the standard substance. Its density is 1000 kg per meter cube. Okay. Okay. Now what is the time?
Sir, break time.
Yeah, break time.